Hello and welcome. My name is Johan Bontes and I'm a researcher at the University of Cape Town and the Hasnout-Plattner Institute, working under the supervision of Professor James Kane. My area of research, optimizing NP-hard problems with local search using Boolean satisfiability, and I'll unpack these concepts in the next few slides. So what is it that we're trying to optimize? Well, complex problems such as, for example, routing. This can be routing of physical things like trucks or planes, or virtual things like network traffic and that sort of concept. Then we have planning. Again, it can be physical or virtual. An example of the latter would be tasks in virtual machines that need to be allocated to a physical machine. And the last example would be bin packing, where we're trying to fit packages of some sort of size, weight, and other characteristics into a fixed number of bins with a set capacity. So these problems fall under a class of problems called NP-hard. One of the characteristics of that is that your search space grows astronomically large, even for small problems, and for large or medium problems, it grows quite a bit larger still. One nice feature is that all these problems can be transformed into every other problems in the class. And another thing is that we can verify solutions in polynomial time. So if we have a given solution that we think is correct, we can actually verify the correctness within a reasonable amount of time. Now, Boolean satisfiability is a technique that casts all of our variables as Booleans, meaning they have the value 1 or 0, true or false, and we have a very small number of operators, and in the end all of our inputs need to be true in order for the output to be true, with or one or more need to be true. We can just pass the signal true as is, or we can negate it, in which case a true turns into a false or a false turns into true. And what we do is we transform any NP-hard integer problem. We can transform that into a circuit. And that circuit then takes a number of Boolean inputs on top and turns this into a true or false value at the outcome. True meaning that all of the constraints that we've codified are satisfied, and false meaning that not all of the constraints are satisfied. Now, applying local search means we use a very simple algorithm to sort of deal with all the complexity that we've added in. With local search, we don't need to know anything about the structure, we just need to be able to push the inputs through and get an output. So what we do is we start with a complete solution, where all of our variables are assigned, either false or true, but none of the variables are unknown. Then we measure the solution. It can be a random solution or maybe some sort of heuristic that we come up with to start. We measure that solution that we've got, and based on the measurements we select a variable to change, make that change, and remeasure to see if we've improved or we've actually gone back. We usually add some sort of randomization in there to prevent us going around in circles. Let's give an example using the knapsack problem, which is a well-known NP-hard problem. So here we have a container with a fixed capacity, in this case 12 kilograms, and we have a number of packages that we would like to fit in there. These packages all have different weights, but they also have a value associated with them. So obviously we would be keen to get the higher value packages in our container. So we have one constraint saying that we must not exceed the total capacity of our container with all these packages. That's the first formula that you see, and then we have a optimizing constraint where we say, okay, we want to maximize the value of our total packages. If we don't allow all our duplicates, then these variables are Boolean, and we have either a 1 or a 0 in a variable, meaning 1 is in the container and 0 is out. So what we do is we split these constraints into hard and soft constraints. Hard constraints are things that must be satisfied, usually because, well, the laws of physics or things we cannot violate. So here we can't exceed the capacity of the container. And we have soft requirements, and those are requirements that we're trying to maximize. So it's okay to violate some of these requirements, but we would rather that as many as possible are satisfied. So what we do then is we translate our initial problem that we stated as a number of constraints into a Boolean encoding. So we make a usually very large circuit out of it. And then we apply a local search. We come up with a reasonable solution to start with, and we gradually try and refine that solution. Okay, what are some of the pros and cons of applying local search? Obviously, our toy knapsack problem, we could model that using some sort of mathematical solution like linear programming or that sort of thing, and that would solve this particular problem very nicely. But some problems are a bit tougher to work on, and then having a new representation gives you new ways of optimizing the problem and new ways of solving this thing. And in fact, for some problems that are hard to solve using other methods, local search is very performant. Another advantage of local search is that it can be parallelized, which is not the case for most other competing methods. So we can run lots of different trials concurrently. Why should you not use local search? Well, it's new technology, so there's still quite a few things that need to be discovered. It doesn't offer any guarantees. So if you want to know that you have the absolute optimal solution, local search will not give you that guarantee. The encoding into the Boolean encoding increases the size quite a bit, in fact, geometrically. Also, it may hide some of the internal structure, which makes it sometimes difficult to apply optimizations that may seem obvious when you just look at the native representation of the problem. So, how is this applied in my research? I have an example where I do bin packing of about 1 million items into 500 bins, and I ran this through a number of local search solvers that work more or less like we've explained before. The first one is a solver called Luandra 2018, and that runs normal Boolean encoded problems through. I mean, it doesn't perform all that well on the example because the encoding of the problem, it's 1 million items, 500 bins, so you're somewhere around the megabyte region, but the encoding makes it quite a bit larger, several gigabytes in fact, and this pushes against the limits of the computer's memory, which is why it doesn't perform all that well. If we find a more clever encoding, where we encode the problem more efficiently, still as Booleans but more efficiently, then we can gain quite a bit more speed, and this is what the ECNF 2020 solver does. And my Kalset solver applies the same principles, the same clever encoding, but uses better heuristics, and then we get even better performance. What's interesting to note is that the starting point of this solve is actually better than the end point of the previous solver. So there's a few key points that I'm trying to do in my research. First is look for clever encodings, and then look for better heuristics that exploit the structure in that encoding. The next part, which is a work in progress, is parallelization. So you can apply many computers to a given problem. Now this may sound wasteful. Say, well, why am I applying 100 computers to a problem when I can just do reasonably well with just one? Let's say you have a limited amount of time. You get input data in, and you have about an hour or a day to come up with a reasonable solution. Obviously, time is the only thing that you can't get back. Once it's passed, it's passed. So in that case, it may be advantageous to apply more computers so that you can get to a better solution within any given time. Parallelization also allows you to do some clever parameter tuning. If you have many machines or many tasks working on the same problem, then you can have all of these different instances running with different parameters, and you can sort of exchange between them which parameters work well and which parameters don't work so well. So that was what I want to explain. I hope I've given you some insight into what I'm doing. The next slide will give you some links to follow if you want to know more about this project. Thank you for listening and goodbye.